wanted to follow up on a line of questioning that you began with Senator Vogel, and that has to do with the lack of veterinarians overall and in those critical practice areas. And the U.S. Department of Agriculture currently lists 7 veterinary services area shortages in Pennsylvania, and 4 of which are listed as a high priority to fill positions and 2 as critical positions to fill. And even though newly graduated vets who fill these positions may be eligible for loan forgiveness programs, these positions are remaining unfilled. So can you talk about what Penn Vet's doing to encourage its graduates to apply for these positions within the Commonwealth?
Right. I think the important thing is that they're educated about the shortage area needs and the profession that they would undertake in those areas, and they understand that what food animal practice is like, and that we inspire and we encourage them to enter that area of practice, because it's true that there are shortage areas that are critically difficult to fill, but we can put them out in the field with our farm animal service and our clinical services out there and our extension services and our outreach, and we can educate them how to be independent. So what is the barrier between them going out there? I think that's one of the issues. And if you ask a panel of food animal focused students, you know, what's keeping you from going out to a shortage area, and they invariably do not say it's the money. They are concerned about mentoring. They're concerned about having information and advice and colleagues on their fingertips in their phone. They're concerned about broadband in that respect. They're concerned about isolation, because we hear about mental health of our veterinarians as being a challenge as well. And money is part of that concern. But really, it's kind of scary for a new grad to go out and work alone. And I did that. But so you're out there in the middle of the night, you're dealing with a problem in the middle of a field somewhere, and it's cold, and you've got a calving or something, and a retainer, I won't say whatever. I don't know how your tolerance is for medical jargon and so forth. But you have to deal with this messy situation and a farmer that might be distraught and unhappy with how you were late or whatever. I mean, it takes an incredibly resilient and enthusiastic new grad to go out and work in that environment. And yet it's the most rewarding environment to be in. So part of it is educating our students about what that experience is like, and putting them in front of farmers and putting them in front of farm veterinarians and getting them out for their externships. So we get them to the Farm Bureau meetings. We get them to the farm show. We get them to talk to farmers. We get them out on externships and internships. And we also try to get them paired up with alumni and have effectively an apprenticeship. So it's a process. And in those shortage areas, the same barriers remain. But I think we also do need to have financial incentives to get additional financial incentives. As in the physician model, we need financial incentives to get people in those areas.
Well, you answered a whole series of questions that I had going forward for you. It sounds like you are working to prepare them to be successful in those rural or semi-rural areas. And as the chair of the Senate Communications and Technology Committee, I can tell you that we have been diligently working to identify how we can further deploy high-speed internet across the Commonwealth. And I will tell you that I had a daughter who had a pony who colicked one night at 3 o'clock in the morning. I was standing in that horse stall with the veterinarian and a sobbing little girl. So I can only imagine what it's like going out into those farms when disaster strikes. Wanted to also follow up with you on this new dual program that you're offering. I think it has great possibilities. As I sat and listened to you talk, I heard you talking about my district, where we have lost rural health care providers, where we struggle to push medical services into those communities. And I think this has a great potential beyond even telemedicine. And I think it's exciting that you're really in uncharted territories. I don't get the sense that there's any existing model that you're basing this on.
Right. That's a really good point. I think This really was something new. There really is no existing model. There is the inverse model where the School of Social Work at Tennessee offers these master's in social work students the opportunity to take some courses on veterinary-related social work in the veterinary school in Knoxville, Tennessee. But the converse, where veterinary graduates can also get simultaneous training in social work, does not currently exist. So there wasn't a previous model, but in terms of providing healthcare services, you can, as well as social services, medical services, there are models, pharmacists, you know, other people, allied professionals that are either deputized or licensed to immunize adults, for example.
Time has expired, but is there anything in this program that would really encourage these graduates to locate in those underserved and unserved rural and semi-rural areas?
Yes, I think there is, and I think it starts from the admissions process. What we've identified is that there are certain students that are applying to vet school that want to do this work. They're just not getting through, or they're not getting the funding, and we're not targeting them for scholarship, and we're not training them to have these extra credentials, and therefore we don't have a pipeline. So it's every step along the way has to be done right, and we'll get there.